Hello dear friends, very very good morning. A lot of people have been asking me about the Prevention of Money Laundering Act. Prevention of Money Laundering Act is very important now because it comes for almost around 5 to 6 marks in CA final, new syllabus, corporate and economic law. It also comes in the economic law elective. So it's a major part, that is Prevention of Money Laundering Act. What exactly is money laundering? So people were asking me all this, so I thought let me make a short video. And obviously should always remember that we cannot read anything theoretically. The only way we can understand any concept is to try and understand it practically. So today I would want to take up a small case, practical case, and that is in the aftermath of the recent tragedy which had V.G. Siddhartha, who is the founder and managing director of Coffee Day, committing suicide based on various financial irregularities, which are still being investigated as we speak. It's a sad day, but it's a sad time going on. But nevertheless, we need to understand what exactly happened and also how can it be linked to our syllabus. So we are not here to do a analysis of what all he did and what all he should not have done. No, it is just a factual description of what exactly happened and what could be the reason because of which he came under severe financial pressure and took the ultimate step, the sad step of committing suicide. So let's just understand, what do you understand by the term money laundering, right? So let me just write down a few things. So we have the Prevention of Money Laundering Act, but the clear thing what we need to understand is what do you mean by money laundering? This word laundering is derived from, honestly, you would have seen this, a laundry. What is this? A laundry. So there are so many illegal businesses like drug trafficking, human trafficking, prostitution, illegal arms dealing. Now all these things, they will get some money. Obviously they won't go to a bank and get money, right? So obviously they will do something which is outside the banking channels. So what exactly is laundering? Laundering, a very important term here, is proceeds of crime. What is it, dear friends? Proceeds of crime. From these proceeds of crime, now money, on the other hand, it could be illegal money, it could be untainted money, or it could be black money. What is the difference between these three, friends? Untainted means there is absolutely no problem with that. It is earned through legal channels and it is deposited into legal channels. There is absolutely no suspicion in this regard. On the other hand, black money could be earned through legal means, but what have you done? You have not disclosed it. You have not disclosed it to the tax authorities. You have not disclosed it. You just get cash somewhere, you do something, you provide some service, you take cash and you do not put it in the bank account. So that it has not come into the system, right? Illegal money is where we need to think about. This is because of the proceeds of crime. And proceeds of crime, because of which it becomes tainted. Tainted. Taint means there is a suspicion and there is an element of illegality that has attached to that particular money. Now how will I convert this tainted money to untainted money as if nothing has happened? How do I do it? And that process is called money laundering. So how did the word launder come about? It was honestly because of these laundry services. What these smugglers and these drug traffickers, human traffickers, what they used to do? They used to open these laundromats all across the city. Way back in the US, you would have heard about a criminal called Al Capone. So he was the guy who actually started this concept. He wanted to convert the tainted money into untainted money. And how do I do that? Very simple. So open all the laundromats here, various across various places, car washes, car washes across various places. And then every day, whatever the tainted money you have, convert to untainted money by simply saying that, so for example, they would have done a business of around 100 cars that day, but he would show as if 500 cars came and get, you know, got washed in that, on that particular day. So 100 cars against 500 cars, so I anyway have tainted money with me. So just raise a bill and say that 1000 cars came today. That's how I convert tainted to untainted. It's not as easy as I'm explaining. Obviously, there are a lot of procedures to be followed. However, there are three things generally in money laundering that they follow. First one is called placement. Placement of the money is breaking it down into small parts and depositing into the bank. Then we have layering. Layering is nothing but moving the money in the system. And finally, integration. Integration is what? Merging the tainted money along with the untainted money as if the entire thing is untainted. Now, all these three things are covered in the concept of money laundering. So before we proceed, I would like to show you a very small video as to what this money laundering is all about. It's a very interesting video. It's by a channel called Minute MBA. Let me just quickly go through that. It's very, very interesting. You'll understand what I'm trying to tell here. Right? Let's see.
Minute MBA, Money Laundering, a hypothetical how-to guide. Part 1, the basics. Let's say you're a drug dealer, a corrupt politician, or a would-be terrorist, and you have a big sack of ill-gotten gains. How big of a sack? $1 million US in cash weighs around 256 pounds. The International Monetary Fund estimates that up to 5% of the world's gross domestic product, or $1.5 trillion, is laundered every year. That's roughly 6 billion pounds, the equivalent of the Wall Street Bull, the Statue of Liberty, and the Eiffel Tower, times 300 every year. Here's how you'd clean your $1 million of dirty money in just three easy steps. Step 1, placement, also known as deposit your cash in a bank. Next to how you make your money, this is the riskiest phase of the laundering process. To prevent banks from reporting you to the government, keep cash deposits to well below $10,000 and spread it out over 160 accounts in 20 or more banks. Step 2, layering, also known as move your money around like crazy. This is the trickiest and possibly most fun stage of the laundering process. Try changing currencies of 20%, buying expensive items like houses, cars, and works of art of 30%, and investing in legitimate businesses with the final 50%. The point is to make the original dirty money impossible to trace. Step 3, integration, also known as collecting your laundry. At this point, your money is no longer dirty. It comes back to you through a seemingly legitimate legal transaction like dividends from a savvy investment in a local Italian eatery, $56,000 to $130,000 a year. The sale of a particularly rare Thomas Kincaid painting of a lighthouse, $200,000. Or the steady stream of income brought to you by your newly acquired car wash, $100,000 to $200,000 a year. Minus various fees, bribes, and taxes, otherwise known as the cost of doing business, you can expect to make up to 80 cents on the dollar and extract your money in as little as 2 or 3 years. To learn more about criminal justice programs,
yes, friends, I hope you understood the basics of what these three things are all about. So in the integration process, what I'm going to do, I'm going to take that, tainted money, merge it with the untainted money by buying some expensive paintings, or I'll just go buy a yacht by the beach and just enjoy. That's how it is. That's how these criminals are laundering money. Now, interesting to know, in our syllabus, we have something to arrest this, and that is part of our syllabus. And what is that called? It is called as the Payment of Money Laundering Act, which came way back in 2002. Let us just understand one concept today, that is, what do you mean by money laundering? So I would like to just show you the definition as such of money laundering. So let's see. So this is the definition, friends, right? Yeah. So money laundering, what is it? So money laundering has the meaning assigned to it in Section 3. Okay. Right. So this is the definition as per Section 2.1p and Section 3. Whosoever directly or indirectly attempts to indulge or knowingly assists or knowingly is a party or actually involved in any process activity connected with the proceeds of crime, including its concealment, possession, acquisition or use, and projecting or claiming it as untainted property, shall be guilty of offense of money laundering, as they say, So let's analyze the definition. Like simply if we read like that, we'll obviously will not understand. So check it out, guys. There are two things here. One is siphoning the funds. What do you mean by siphoning of funds? That is one part of it. And one more is actually the concept of money laundering. Siphoning of funds is what? Now I get some money from my services. I put it in my company. So like that, all the directors work and the company works and everything is put in the company. However, I slowly through other means take some money out without anybody's knowledge. That is called siphoning of funds. Now, is that money laundering? May or may not be. Money laundering is a concept which is of wide amplitude. It has a wide meaning. So let us try and understand through a chart as to what could be, you know, money laundering. So let us see. So as I told you earlier, this is what it was. They used laundromats and converted clean money, and you know, they hung it like that. That's what, that is conversion of blood money, so to speak, to untainted money. That's what happened, right? Next. So you see all these guys, you would have seen a lot of shows, guys. I am sure you would have seen a lot of shows on Netflix. One we have, Narcos, you remember Pablo Escobar? So that's what he did. He was a drug lord. Then he was expert at conversion of, you know, the tainted money into untainted money. I would not say black money. Black money is unaccounted for. But this is money from proceeds of crime, right? Then you would have watched one more. This is a relatively new show. Probably when you're free, you should watch. It's called Ozark. So here, one person, a financial analyst played by Jason Bateman, he gets embroiled in some a drug deal. And the drug deal goes wrong. And now for the rest of his life, he has to sit and convert and completely launder the entire process. So actually you learn the process in that just for your knowledge. Don't apply in practical life. As chartered accountants, we should really be responsible and ethical, and we should not indulge in, advising our clients on all these things. Third one, this is probably rated as the best ever series ever. That's Breaking Bad. I watched all the three. I'm a huge lover of these shows. Breaking Bad broke all records, and it's widely regarded as the number one show of all time. So here, a seemingly innocuous chemistry professor starts to, you know, create drugs, methamphetamine to be exact, and he, you know, makes these drugs, and then he indulges in money laundering. In fact, he in this particular show opens a lot of laundromats. So it's a very good show. Anyway, so you would have seen so many things on TV, but probably you never would have seen a practical case. That is what I'm here to discuss about. Let's discuss the Coffee Day case and understand whether it is actually money laundering or whether it is not money laundering. Is it siphoning of funds? All that we will check it out. Right? So this is how it is. So you see this guy. This guy has come here to, wash his clothes. This guy has come here to wash his money. Right? So that's how it is. Anyway, so now let us understand the definition, friends. Here, let us understand the definition of money laundering. Yes, what is money laundering? Process or activity where there is the proceeds of crime. Proceeds of crime. Is there proceeds of crime arising from what? From the property. Proceeds of crime arising from the property. Now, what is this property? We'll see. Property could be derived or obtained in India or outside India, whether directly or indirectly. Or let's say the property is abroad, not just the property, but also the value of property, either in India or abroad, right? Directly or indirectly, but through what means? Through either through concealment as to hide, possession, acquisition, use of what? Of that particular property, but projecting it or claiming it as if it's an untainted property. As I told you, conversion of a tainted property or money derived from the tainted property and conversion of that and showing as if it's an untainted property is called as your money laundering. And but very important to know, in money laundering, however, the most important thing should be, it should be a criminal activity related to a scheduled offense. So the most important thing here is it should be a scheduled offense. What is scheduled offense? Obviously, it is part of the schedule. We have part A, B and C. Part B is actually merged with part A now. So I can simply say part A and part C. Let us understand what you mean by those scheduled offense. So if any of these things happens, what happens, friends? There should be a proceed of crime deriving from the property. property can be derived or obtained directly or indirectly in India, outside India, including the value. And what do? I conceal, I possess the property, or I acquire the property, or use the property, and project as if it is a untainted property. So that is what we are dealing here with. Now, what is a property? It could be anything, guys. It could be corporeal, incorporeal. It could be a movable, immovable asset. It could be tangible, intangible. It could even be deeds or instruments. Like even, I have a building. So even the building title deed will be a property. So if you see the definition of property, it says deeds or instruments evidencing title. So even that could be the property. So this is what I want you to understand, that ultimately it talks about proceeds of crime, and the key word is what? It should be related to a criminal activity, related to a scheduled offense. Now I will take you to FIU. What is that? Financial Intelligence Unit website. That along with the Enforcement Directorate work together to analyze all these transactions and see which person is doing what and stuff. So let us see the website, dear friends. Let us understand it practically. So this is the FIU website, that is the Financial Intelligence Unit, it's part of the Ministry of Finance. So these are all the offenses. See, I'll just zoom in. These are the offenses. Let's see directly from the source document. Let's not open some normal PDF where it's not updated. This is the actual Government of India website, which is definitely updated. So these are the offenses. See, what is it? Proceeds of crime in respect of property connected to a scheduled offense. What schedule? A and C. I told you B is already merged with A. Now, criminal conspiracy, waging or abetting war, conspiracy to commit offenses punishable by 121. Then, using a genuine or government staff to be account, murder. Murder is also using the proceeds of crime to commit murder is part of this. Attempt to murder, culpable homicide, extortion, ransom, dishonestly receiving stolen property, punishment for cheating. You see here, punishment for cheating. All these are part of the offenses that we need to understand. Then we have so many things. If you just see, there are so many laws covered here, so many sections covered of the Indian Penal Code and other things. Paragraph 2, there are so many paragraphs, by the way. Paragraph 2 talks about the narcotic drugs. This I was telling about Narcos or Breaking Bad. So everything here. Paragraph 3 about the explosive substances. Paragraph 4 about unlawful activities, unlawful association, unlawful activity. So one we have here that speaks about cheating, right? Punishment for cheating the public, right? Cheating and dishonesty, we call some persons 420, right? This 420 is actually derived from section 420 of the Indian Penal Code. So if I, or also dishonestly or fraudulently preventing debt being available for creditors, looting creditors' money, everything is covered in this proceeds of crime. Mostly everything is there, right? Then you have the Arms Act, then your Wildlife Protection Act. You've been seeing hunting of wild animals. Classic example, Mr. Salman Khan, who hunted the black buck and is still facing the music for, because of that. All this will come under the Prevention of Money Laundering Act. So customs, most of it is covered. Juvenile Justice Act, Immigration Act, Passport, Copyright Act, Trademark Act, Information Technology, Environmental Protection, Water Pollution Prevention, Water Prevention and Control of Pollution, Air Prevention and Control of Pollution Act, so many things. Part C, however, talks about all offenses under Part A, which has cross-border implications. Means from this country to the other country, across the border. So if you have any property outside India, all that is covered under Part Number C. Fine, these are all the theory points. Let us now honestly get into why we are all here today. We will get into the actual deal. I want to explain to you one part, that is the case in respect of Cafe Coffee Day. So let us directly dive into that, friends. Cafe Coffee Day case, whether it is PMLA, not PMLA. Yes, so I have tried to analyze in this master chart, which I'll be sharing with you. You can check the link below, or you could also message me on my Telegram channel, which the details are given below in the ticker. You can check it out. You can message me. You will get this chart. I can share this with you, no problem. Now, how did this entire thing start? Suddenly, we had V.G. Siddhartha, who was considered to be a very, very humble person. He definitely was a very humble person. He was one of the few people from Karnataka, Bangalore, and who took the concept of coffee across India, not just across India, across the world. He had given employment directly to almost 50 to 60,000 people of our country. You can see the Cafe Coffee Day across various places in the country, and it's not just here, it's also in Austria, it's also in Czech Republic. So he truly took India, the concept of coffee, which is much loved in India, across the world. But what happened? What happened? Let's see. So we have the previous chief minister of our country, ex-chief minister Shri S.M. Krishna, right? So his protege was D.K. Shivkumar. He is considered as one of the richest politicians in the country. Why? Because his declared assets are 700 crore, my dear friend. 700 crore are his declared assets. Forget about undeclared. Declared assets are 700 crore, right? And he has a mall in Dubai, friends. Not in Bangalore, not in any part of India, a mall in Dubai. And picture this, he has a house in Birmingham and 125 flats in Mumbai. Well, I have nothing to say. 125, not one, not two, 125. And his declared assets are 700 crore, as I told you. Now, how is D.K. Shivkumar linked to this entire Coffee Day scandal? Let us see. So, S.M. Krishna's protege, D.K. Shivkumar, tax department in the year 2017, they raid D.K. Shivkumar's house. There they find, believe it or not, 8.6 crore cash. This is it. This is the actual cash which was photographed in D.K. Shivkumar's house when we were speaking about no money demonetization. Look at this. These are bundles of 2000 rupee notes, 8.6 crore cash. Anyway, let me also give a disclaimer that this video is not to malign any person or malign any political party. I am least interested or least bothered among all these things, but I just want to give an, I have done extensive research on the Coffee Day case, and I just wanted to let you know or just share whatever I knew about this case. Only facts. Let us not judge anyone here, only facts. But he had 700 crore property, then he had declared assets so much, and he had 125 flats. S.M. Krishna, previous chief minister. Now, what is the link? Now, S.M. Krishna's son-in-law is our V.G. Siddhartha. Son-in-law is V.G. Siddhartha, right? Anyway, what is the link? We'll see. Now, come back. So, D.K. Shivkumar's, when they were actually checking all the details as to how this cash was there, and they opened up all the books and they were checking income tax authorities, and way back in 2017, they found the daughter's books as well. And daughter had some dealings with certain companies and all that. This was all told by Mr. N. Chandrasekhar, who was the financial assistant of Mr. D.K. Shivkumar. Obviously, under investigation and interrogation, he spilled the beans. Now, they found a very peculiar case. Cafe Coffee Day had transferred 20 crore. Mind you, Cafe Coffee Day is a listed company. At the time of V.G. Siddhartha's disappearance, it was running at, if I'm not wrong, around 160 rupees or so. And immediately after his disappearance and 1 or 2 days after his death, it became 120, and I think today it's around 80 rupees. That's how it is. We may say Solomon versus Solomon, the company is different from the management, but no. People obviously see the man behind the company, the persons behind the company, and only then invest. Isn't it not, dear friends? Do you look at the company alone or do you look at the directors? Obviously, you look at both, the financial performance and the man behind the show. The man behind the show is dynamic. You would definitely invest in that company, right? Now, let's see. Right? So, daughter, what happened? 20 crore. Suddenly, how come 20 crore? Where did it come from? So, they were analyzing it. Then they found out that this 20 crore is routed through so many layers, so many different companies. And in the end, they have given it to some company called Messar Soul Space. So many layers. This company invested in this company in this company, second, third company, fourth company, fifth company. And then suddenly it went to Messar Soul Space. How is it possible? 20 crore. So now they decided to investigate VG Siddhartha, because now they realize this is something is fishy here, I'll have to investigate VG Siddhartha. Now, when they investigated Mr. VG Siddhartha, they found Cafe Coffee Day has concealed income. See, this can be black money, this can be legally derived, but then I have not deposited. It could be, but it can't be because it's a listed company, because everything will be obviously accounted for, but it's unaccounted. How is it possible? Maybe it is black money, or is it illegal money? Are you getting it? Is it black money or illegal money is what I need to check. Black money could be both legal and illegal, because black money is simply unaccounted money. It could take a legal flavor or it could be illegal. Concealed income of how much? Not one, not two, 650 crore. Picture that. And his personal income unaccounted was 362 crore. This was what it was, right? Then what happened? Now we have VG Siddhartha here. The income tax sleuths investigated this entire thing. They realized that here, RDK Shivkumar was close friends with the owner of a transport company called Sharma Transport. Sharma Transport is a known name for money laundering in the circles. So when they understood that VG Siddhartha had a close associate called Mr. Dikshit, he was an employee. So what had happened, VG Siddhartha along with Dikshit and DK Shivkumar's company, along with Sharma Transport, and also we have the director finance of CCD, Mr. Monish Gopinath, all of them appeared to allegedly conspire and, you know, route money outside the country. So when the income tax raid happened, they found a person called Mr. Rajneesh Gopinath. Now, who is Rajneesh Gopinath? He is a person living in Singapore, Singaporean citizen, but of course Indian, living in Singapore. Who happens to be, surprise, surprise, who? The brother of Monish Gopinath. And who is Monish Gopinath? Director Finance of Cafe Coffee Day. So, you're understanding the picture here. So, we have, let me just zoom out to make you understand the full thing. So, we have our DK Shivkumar, who through Sharma Transports have numbered it for you to understand. 5A, first step is they found out concealed income, it was unaccounted and personal in nature. Then they targeted VG Siddhartha and they started interrogating him and also checking all his books. There they found that is, you know, first is your Sharma Transport 5B, through Dikshit 5C, and this guy Monish Gopinath 5D, and in the end it reaches where? Rajneesh Gopinath, who's in Singapore. And very, very unfortunately, they found messages between VG Siddhartha and all these guys, Sharma Transport, Dikshit, Monish Gopinath, Rajneesh Gopinath, DK Shivkumar, which indicated that he knew very much what was happening. Not that he was not in the know, he really knew what was happening. This is what happened. Yes. Then this is nothing but hawala transaction. That is circumventing the RBI mechanism, going outside. That is the hawala transaction. That is what it did. That is one part of it, right? This is one part. So he had around 1 to 2 crore, which was in the name of Mr. VG Siddhartha. So Rajneesh Gopinath was apprehended and they found around 2 crore rupees, which belonged to Mr. VG Siddhartha. Now, this is what happened. Part number one. Now, moving on, they again further delved in deep. What is the issue? What has happened? How has the money been routed outside? How is this hawala transaction happening? So now, here, there was again a play between three companies. One is Devadarshini Infotech Private Limited. All these are owned by Vijay Siddhartha, or he was a director, member, whatever. He was there, part of it. Some of it is part of the CCD group as well. Have you ever observed in Cafe Coffee Day, every around 4 to 5 months, in each cafe, in each, coffee shop, they used to change the entire furniture. Have you observed, guys? How did they get so much money? How did they get so much wood? How did they get so much timber? Is a question that you should really now think about. So this is how it was. There was a company called Devadarshini Infotech Private Limited, which was showing 15 crore loss in the books. It was a bogus company with absolutely no employees. Zero employees, think about it. And what was the business of this company as per the memorandum of association? Computer peripherals, that is trading in computer peripherals, computer parts, which we all use. Now friends, here's the best part. There is one company called Vaitarna Timber Private Limited, which obviously is in India. Vaitarna Timber Private Limited subsidiary is called Vaitarna Holding. Don't get confused, it is not a holding company, it's a subsidiary company. But it's called as Vaitarna Holding Private Limited. It is in Guyana, in South America. It's a tax haven. So no tax, or tax at very, very less rates there. Now, that's the best part. This was into timber business. This was into timber business. Now, Vaitarna Holding Private Limited. Now, I have to now, through Hawala transaction, send money outside the country. How do it? Vaitarna Holding Private Limited used to sell timber. To whom? Not to Vaitarna Timber, sorry, Vaitarna Holding Private Limited, which is in Guyana, used to sell timber to whom? Not to Vaitarna Timber Private Limited, no. It used to sell directly to Devadarshini Infotech Private Limited. Now you'll be wondering, what does a computer peripheral company do with timber? Now here's the deal. It was sometimes routed through Vaitarna Timber Private Limited also. So imagine timber worth 1 crore was being sold for 3 crore, 4 crore, etc. So some of the untainted money, as proclaimed by V.G. Siddhartha and associates, was actually derived from this, where Vaitarna Holding Private Limited sold the timber of 1 crore for 4 crore. Now, from India, money is going out how much? 4 crore. How much timber is coming? 1 crore. So, 4 crore rupees went outside the country, which was a tax haven through Hawala market. Through Hawala market. Yeah, so Vaitarna Holding Private Limited in Guyana, which is a tax haven, procured money worth 4 crore for the sale of timber worth just 1 crore. Then there were a lot of companies here. It's not as easy as I am actually putting it here. It's very, very complicated. Lot of companies. It went through so many companies. All shell corporations. Right? So this happened. And then it came back to Vaitarna Holding. So there was one scam. Now, why would a computer peripheral company do all this? It's really absurd to the mind. Now the best part, what happened to the timber? Some timber was used for revamping all the cafes at a dirt cheap rate, because now Devadarshini now sold it at a loss for them to CCD, got it? And some of the timber apparently got lost during transit, if you know what I mean. That's what the Devadarshini Infotech Private, when the income tax department asked them, boss, you are a computer peripheral company, what are you doing with timber? They had absolutely no answer. They said, no, we were taking it in transit, it got lost, I met with an accident, so many reasons. And they were actually selling it to CCD at a dirt cheap rate, because of which you would see that every 3 months, 4 months, 5 months, the entire, interiors are changed everywhere. And they were selling at a loss, and Devadarshini used to actually purchase it at a bomb from Vaitarna Holding. Vaitarna Timber Private Limited also was involved. This is the second set. First set was the Hawala transaction, which is part of the Companies Act. And we have our FEMA regulations for that. We have SEBI, because it's a listed company, mind you. Right? Now, Vaitarna Timber Private, this is one set. One is Hawala transaction and one is this. Hawala transaction we'll see in FEMA. And this we see in the other modes. I'll talk to you about the shell corporation in a while. Now, this was one part of it. And the story doesn't end here. There was one more company, Ardiono Holdings. Now, Ardiono Holdings was somewhere in Cyprus. Cyprus is a country in the Middle East. And surprise, surprise, Cyprus is a tax haven again. Now, Ardiono Holdings lent some money to Cafe Coffee Day, CCD as it popularly was called. CCD issued CCD. What is this CCD? Cumulative Convertible Debentures, right? Ardiono Holdings lent some money to CCD, and CCD issued Cumulative Convertible Debentures. And this money obviously was diverted through various processes everywhere. So that money is gone. Don't know where the money is now. They're still tracking it. And eventually, they obviously could not pay back the debentures. So coolly, what did they do on a Companies Act provisions? They converted the debentures into equity shares. So for what value did they lend? Was it undervalued, overvalued? All that investigation is on. This is one part of the deal. So first, I spoke about Hawala transaction. Second, I spoke about this internal layering deal. Third one, I'm talking about again conversion of the debentures into equity shares. The story doesn't end there, friends. Next, CCD Vijay Siddhartha had very close ties with the managers of Lakshmi Vilas Bank. Lakshmi Vilas Bank lent money to the employees of Cafe Coffee Day. And Cafe Coffee Day employees started slowly buying shares of Coffee Day. Can a company buy back its own shares? No. Company cannot buy back its own shares, but this looks like indirect buyback. Interestingly, this is allowed under Companies Act 67(3)(b). If you read 3(b) and 3(c), it is allowed. I can give loan to my employee who can actually buy shares of my company. It's allowed. But here, this employees were buying shares allegedly by the tax department. They said later they were buying shares of CCD to increase the price of CCD, to create that demand for CCD shares. Now, they knew that something was going to happen and they had access to some unpublished price sensitive information maybe, and the directors were doing this, asking the employees to buy. All this may, in the near after investigation, this may become a part of the insider trading. So friends, first I spoke about Hawala, which is our FEMA regulations. Then now I'm speaking about insider trading. Now I'm talking about all these layers here. I'll come to the layers. Layers is covered under 186(1) of the Companies Act, and subsidiary layers is covered under 2 subsection 87 of the Companies Act, right? Now, this is the next deal. So seeing all this, income tax department like, boss, what are we doing here? So at the same time, in way back in 2000, VG Siddhartha had bought certain shares of Mindtree Consultancy. Mindtree. You would have seen Mindtree recently was in the news because L&T wanted to take over, hostile takeover, but they stopped it from happening. But VG Siddhartha had a sufficient number of shares there. Income tax department attached those shares because they knew that so many things are happening. VG Siddhartha owed department almost around 360 crores or something. So they said, boss, I'm going to attach the shares. Now, VG Siddhartha was in a deal with L&T, wanted to sell the shares. And of course, use that money, working capital, for other things. But it was not to be. So VG Siddhartha sold it for 3,600 crore. But mind you, there was a condition attached by the income tax department. Only if all the loans that VG Siddhartha had taken personally and other things had to be paid off, tax you had to pay. So from all the money he pumped in to repay some of the loans, and he paid 41 crore out of 362 crore tax. What about the remaining? Since the shares were already sold, now income tax department said, I am going to attach the shares held by VG Siddhartha in his own company, Cafe Coffee Day. Cafe Coffee Day. So he said, I am going to attach those shares. Now it is enough. I will attach those, because Mindtree also was not able to attach. Now I am going to attach these shares. So after all these things, VG Siddhartha wanted the CCD shares because he wanted his shares, he wanted to keep it as security somewhere else and get some more working capital, because CCD was a loss-making company, no doubt about it. So what happened next is what I'm going to discuss. So at the time of his disappearance, there was a discussion on the distress sale of a global village technological park which is there in Bangalore. He wanted to sell it for 2,800 crore, and they were also in talks with Coca-Cola to take over Cafe Coffee Day or buy a stake in Cafe Coffee Day. But then Obviously, to get more working capital, he needed those shares. Now, tax department not only took a position on Mindtree, but also took a position on the Cafe Coffee Day shares, which created a lot of havoc, and probably this was the tip of the iceberg. I'm very sure about it. There are some more things to be unearthed. So Siddhartha was always a man who always felt that his self-worth was way more than the net worth. But after doing business for so many years, probably thought that maybe net worth is better, and the greed took the better of him, unfortunately, and it got the better of him. And it's very, very sad, guys, very, very sad that a person who was so humble and who did business seemingly ethically to the outside world had to meet a fate of death. He could not face the pressure. If you analyze his letter also, before that I'll just want to show you the balance sheet as on 31st March 19 of Coffee Day. You see the reserves are 1,665 crores, loss whatever, and shares. All the money, if you see the asset, this is just a summary balance sheet. If you see, shockingly, the entire money, majority of the money is lying with the subsidiary companies. This clearly indicates diversion of funds. So take money from the public and divert it to all the subsidiary companies. Like I told you, Devadarshini Holding and all those things. It's very staggering that none of the people checked this and reported this. There is a lot of flack on the auditors now. I mean, it has been since a past few days with ILFS, with Bhushan Steels, with DHFL, and it's kind of sad that it is now the NFRA is taking us to task, and even the MCA, and we have the Serious Fraud Investigation Office. So it's bad time going on for the chartered accountant and for the auditor. Nevertheless, one more thing I just want to show you would be the letter which was written by V.G. Siddhartha, right, just before it disappeared. Let me show you that. Well, this was the letter, friends, that he wrote to the board of directors and Coffee Day family after 37 years, strong commitment to hard work, having directly created 30,000 directly and 20,000 indirectly and all these things. I have failed to create the right profitable business. It's very sad to read this letter. And if you see, whatever we discuss is there in this, there's a hint. I would like to say I gave it my all. I'm very sorry to let down all the people that put their trust in me. I fought for a long time, but today I gave up, as I could not take any more pressure from one of the private equity partners. I think this is the Standard Chartered Bank who had given money, now they wanted it back, forcing me to buy back shares. Transaction I had partially completed 6 months ago by borrowing large sum of money from a friend. Tremendous pressure from other lenders led me to succumbing to the situation. There was a lot of harassment from the previous DG Income Tax in the form of attaching our shares. Remember the Mindtree deal? On two separate occasions to block our Mindtree deal, and also then taking possession of our Coffee Day shares. Although the revised returns have been filed. This is this part that I've discussed. So he wanted to sell it to L&T, but then this income tax wanted to attach the shares, and then eventually they let him sell it with his conditions, and they attached the CCD shares, which he has written here, which have been, and again then taking possession of our Coffee Day shares, although the revised returns were filed. So he had disclosed all this 360 crore, and he had told that, sorry, this is the income I have to pay. Despite that, they attached the Coffee Day shares. I sincerely request each of you to be strong and continue to run the business. And he has given, every financial transaction is my responsibility. My team, auditors and senior managers are totally unaware of all my transactions. The law should hold me and only me accountable, as I have withheld this information for everybody, including my family. My intention was never to cheat or mislead. I have failed as an entrepreneur. It is a very, very sad statement, dear friends, from a person who was a very, very successful entrepreneur to be not in a position to understand, or rather handle the pressure he was in. This is my sincere submission. I hope someday you will understand, forgive and pardon me. I have enclosed a list of our assets and tentative value of each asset. As seen below, our assets outweigh our liabilities and can help repay everybody. On 27th July, he signed it. 28th. he disappeared. And yeah, 28th he committed, 28th or 29th committed suicide. And DK Shivkumar received a call from Viji Siddhartha and he said, I would like to meet you. But DK Shivkumar was busy, so he said, I'll meet you tomorrow. But that tomorrow never happened. This is the entire deal. So for our syllabus, you can see you have the insider trading point here. You have the FEMA regulation, Hawala transaction. And now I told you that I'll talk about this layering. What is this layering? It's very simple, that one between one company and the other company having many layers. So if I have company one and company two doing business through investing in various layers, complex layers of investment companies. That is one. Or as you can see in Coffee Day, the major chunk of money is lying in the subsidiaries. So if Coffee Day is there, then subsidiary 1, subsidiary 2, then here one more subsidiary 3, then there's an interlink subsidiary 4, all these things, and dealing with the final other company, which probably would be a tax haven, right? Now, to curb these two things, it's already there in the Companies Act now, Companies Act 2013 with amendment as per 2017. This is covered in 186 subsection 1, which now says that one company and the second company, between that there should only be two layers. That is as per Companies Act, two layers. Here on the other hand, also with respect to subsidiary, we have to see 2 subsection 87, which says one holding company can maximum have two subsidiaries. That's it. And I'm talking about vertical integration, subsidiary 1, subsidiary 2. But what about CCD, which had many subsidiaries? What about Reliance? It has 100 odd subsidiaries and associates. What about that? So this law came sometime in September 2017. So anything before that is grandfathered, means I have to ignore. But any company or any existing company or a new company after September 2017, they are not supposed to have more than 2 subsidiaries in a vertical integration, not horizontal. Horizontal, they can have as many. Vertical integration is the deal. Again, now would this amount to, what do you say, the entire CCD deal, would this amount to money laundering is the question. Definitely, there is laundering of money. But definitely, there is proceeds of crime. Crime here being any of the scheduled offenses there. One of simple reason is to cheat and to deprive of the creditor of their money. But yeah, it goes on to show that even humble people, even very good businessmen, at some point of time falter and they want to circumvent the law and indulge in so many things. As you can see in this case of Cafe Coffee Day, a lot can definitely happen over coffee. That's the tagline, a lot can happen over coffee, and so many things have happened. But sincerely, friends, whatever happens has happened, but it should not have led to the death of Mr. V.G. Siddhartha. Probably he should have faced the music, but anyway, we are not to judge, we were not in his position to undergo what he was going through. Whatever it is, may his soul rest in peace. But I took up this case to just give you a gist of how practically understanding Companies Act, practically understanding insider trading, that is your unpublished price sensitive information, practically understanding FEMA regulations, practically understanding PMLA can go a long way in helping us becoming great chartered accountants. A sincere request, please do not read any textbook and just mug up the answers. That's not the way to study company law. Company law has to be studied using the Bayer Act, line by line, clause by clause, and trying to interconnect so many things. So this case, I found so many interconnections I could make. That's why I thought that I could share this with you. So I would like to thank you, dear friends, for watching. I took some of your time, but I hope this was of use. If you like the video, you could subscribe to our channel, Advait Learning. So we will be posting a lot of videos, interesting videos. You can hit the bell icon so that any video you should not miss. And if you want to buy any of our products, we have pen drives for corporate law, for IDT and other things, you can check our website www.advaitlearning.com. I mean, that's beside the point. This, I really wanted to share whatever I knew or whatever I could analyze from the Coffee Day case. Thank you so much. Be strong. One lesson we can learn is however much money we can make. Siddhartha was valued at, I think, almost 10,000 crore. What really matters is the peace of mind we have. So let us not indulge in any of these things. Let us be responsible chartered accountants. Thank you so much for watching. Cheers.